In December 1986, during the fall of 1985, Dr. John Fordyce, working quietly on a serum to combat a deadly virus that was threatening to exterminate all London's estate agents and thus reduce house prices at a stroke, happened upon Floric 19, a remarkable semi-genetic plasma whose fantastic properties he only became aware of when he accidentally injected himself with an untested sample of the substance one balmy spring evening in the mid-60s in his laboratory in London's fashionable Edinburgh sometime during 1958.
Fordyce Lab Notes, Tape 7. Testing. I have injected 30 milligrams of Floric 19 into my thigh. So far, I feel no effects whatsoever. I can see clearly, think clearly. 77's a 49. The capital of Australia is Canberra. The Prime Minister of Great Britain is Margaret Thatcher. 12-12s are 144. No discernible contraindications whatever. Wait a minute. Something's happening to my chest. My flesh is expanding. The hairs on the back of my hand, they're disappearing.
Predictable as it seems, something was happening to Dr. John Fordyce.
My God. Something is happening to me. I've turned into a woman. There isn't any doubt about it. I have two unmistakable breasts and... Oh! I'm unquestionably a woman. 77's are 77. The capital of Australia is A. I'm even thinking differently, intuitively, freed from the shackles of logic and reason. I must note carefully the effects of this drug. But first, I have so many thank you letters to catch up on. I never wrote to Andre and Judith thanking them for that dinner party in 77. Dear Judy, just a brief note to...
And so, Jenny Flamisto was born. But back in Belgravia's fashionable London, over the months, Dr. Fordyce learned to control the drug, whose effects would wear off after 3 hours, transforming him back from Jenny Flamisto to hard-working John Fordyce. But his alter ego, Jenny, was no ordinary woman.
When I am Jenny, and this must be some strange property of Floric 19, I have extraordinary powers. If I half close my eyes and stare very hard, I'm able to understand and appreciate a lot of modern art that I used to consider rubbish. My movements are much more regular than I have any right to expect, and I seem to have no trouble at all programming the video correctly. Oh, and I can fly, make myself invisible, throw my voice, and see through things.
With these extraordinary powers, Fordyce, as Jenny, was able to use her gifts to create a massive fortune for herself, carving out a criminal empire that stretched from one place to another one quite a long way away from it. One man knew of her secret, American-born radio announcer Don McElwain. And he, using stolen tape recordings of Fordyce's original experiment, planned to expose Jenny Flamisto for what she was on national radio. But even while he was broadcasting, Jenny Flamisto burst into the small studio in London's central London and confronted the one man who stood between her and her crazed ambitions.
So, Don McElwain, you dare to expose me?
We're on air, she-wolf. Anything you say will be broadcast to literally people.
You fool. Hmm? You puny fool. You feeble fool. You feeble, puny fool. You foony, peeble fool. You fooly, phenal pube. With one thought, I can hypnotize a whole audience into thinking that they are listening to whatever I choose. Even as we speak, they think they are listening to...
The streets of Cabu Damble bustle with life as early as 6 o'clock in the morning as the bright dews that sweep down from the Bashed Mountains drape themselves around the tall, mud-daubed buildings of the old colonial residence, a piquant reminder of the all-but-forgotten days of British rule. Emmerich Lurgen, grateful for the weekly opportunity to talk in pseudo-literary journalese, Cabu Damble.
That report from Roger Dalton in Hyannaskull ends this edition of From Our Own Correspondent.
And From Our Own Correspondent was produced in our Bristol studios by Haranita Dench. And now, before the news and weather, here is the shipping forecast issued by the Meteorological Office at 1400 hours Greenwich Mean Time. Finisterre, Dogger, Rockall, Bailey, no. Wednesday, variable, imminent, super. South at Cira, North at Cira, Sheerness, Foulness, Elliotness. If you will, often, eminent, 447, 22 yards, touchdown, stupidly. Malin, Hebrides, Shetland, Jersey, Fair Isle, Turtleneck, Tank Top, Cortell, blowy, quite misty, seasickness. Not many fish around, come home, veering suggestively. That was the shipping forecast for 0700 hours, Wednesday the 18th of August. And now here is an urgent message for a Mr. Timothy Wilton of Hemel Hempstead. Will Mr. Timothy Wilton, last believed to be on a bicycling holiday in Beaconsfield, please return home immediately, where his mother is seriously annoyed about how untidy his bedroom is.
You see? They can hear nothing but normal radio output. Your plan has failed, Dom McElwain.
Wrong, Jenny Flamisto. They're listening to us now.
What? How did you... No one could have interfered with my broadcast projection like that. No one. Unless
they had taken Floric 19 too? Yes. You've met your match, Jenny Flamisto. Meet...
Barry Cryer.
But you, I...
Following the instructions on your lab tapes, I formulated the serum and injected myself with it.
Why, that is you. I never think...
Instead of turning into a woman, I turned into Barry Cryer. I may have left out some vital ingredient, but don't underestimate me. I am packed with strange powers. Amongst my supernatural gifts, I have the remarkable ability to find something suggestive and naughty in anything you say.
But that's extraordinary.
Extraordinary? At my age, it's a miracle.
But it's horrifying.
It is horrifying, isn't it? I'll put it away. There, you see what I mean? A lewd ambiguity for every occasion.
You're having me on.
No, but it's an idea.
You can keep this up indefinitely.
Are you sure you want me to answer that?
All right, if you can twist any remark I might make, try this. Buttercup.
Buttercup, buttock down. Buttercup, buttock down. And rest. Thank you, madam.
Curses, that was too easy. I'll try another. Anti-tank missile.
You flatter me, but you should see it when it's angry.
I don't get it.
I'll soon put a stop to that.
My God, you have actually become Barry Cryer. Your double entendres are staggering.
Only when I cough.
Well, if you really are Barry Cryer, would you mind signing this? It's for my children.
I don't remember ordering any children.
I can have them biked over to you tomorrow. The youngest is allergic to eggs. Apart from that, there should be no trouble. Please sign for them. There's a dotted line on the bottom there.
There's a novelty.
Well, quite.
And as Saint-Saëns' organ concerto fades away, we come to that part of the programme in which we copy, rather shamelessly, but with deep respect, an idea which has been seen on your television screens as Jim'll Fix It. We call it Stephen Will Do His Level Best to Comply with Your Wishes. And our first letter comes from Michael Thompson, aged 7. Dear Stephen, please would you do your level best to comply with my wish to go up in a hot air balloon? No. Now, a letter here from Rebecca Taylor? Oh, this is the most atrocious handwriting. I'm not doing my level best to comply with any wish from this one here. Now, what are they teaching them these days? Onward and upward. Here's one from Yasmin Schofield, aged 12. Dear Stephen, please can you do your level best to comply with my wish for there to be world peace and no more hungry people in the world? Well, as a matter of fact, I can, Yasmin, yes, but I don't think we'd make very good radio, do you? Now, dear Stephen, please, 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 yes, 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 yes. Please, 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 could you do your level best to comply with my wish to interview David Bowie from Jackie Fry, aged 12? P.S. I think your program's great, Uncle Stephen. Right. Well, we'll do our level best for you, Jackie, and this is what happened. Jackie and I are standing outside David Bowie's London pied-à-terre. I wonder if he's in. What do you think, Jackie?
Don't know.
Well, we'll know soon enough. You excited, Jackie?
Yes.
Oh, it's him.
Hello?
Hello, David. It's Stephen Fry here from Saturday Night Fry. I have a young friend with me, and we were wondering... That's Fry, and we were wondering... F-R-Y.
Yeah.
That's right. We were wondering if we might come in, listen to some of your discs, and have a little chat. Oh, well, when will he be back?
Well,
can we come in and wait for him, do you think? Oh, I see. Well, where would you suggest we go?
Mm-hmm.
Well, I hardly think we'll find Mr. Bowie there, attractive though the thought may be. Hello? Hello? Oh. Well, so, anyway, Jackie, that was the actual outside of David Bowie's flat. On to the next stage of our complying with your wishes. I think a visit to a real pop music recording studio is in order. Can we come in and wait?
No.
I see. Our next stop was Hammersmith and the Metropolitan Police car pound for an absorbing afternoon spent searching for my car. What? But this is absurd. I was recording a radio programme.
£45.
Oh, very well. Jackie, have you got £5? Jackie? Right. The next port of call was Great Ormond Street Hospital for sick children.
Hello, Jackie. I've brought you some grapes.
Now, it was very silly of you to run away, wasn't it, Jackie? Especially as I've got a car. You know you didn't stand a chance. Never mind. I've brought along a rather special visitor for you. Yes, it's Hugh.
Hello.
Did you go to that film in the end, Hugh?
Yes, I did, yeah.
Well, after all that, we invited Jackie to come and join us in the studio today. But she refused. Which was very stupid of her, because sitting next to me right now is David Bowie. Hello.
Hello.
So, up yours, Jackie, with a wire brush. And now, my final letter. Dear Stephen, can you do your level best to comply with my wish to appear in the next item with you? Yours in a fever of anticipation, Hugh Laurie. Really, Hugh, I would have hoped that you thought you knew me well enough not to need to ask that. The answer, in fact, is no, because we're going straight away now over to Professor Florian Bilney of the School of Anglo-Velvic Studies with the third of his...
You see, Don McElwain or Barry Cryer or whatever you call yourself, your powers are fading. They are all listening to normal radio output again.
Don't be too sure, Jenny Flamisto. One more sip of Floric 19... And I can turn myself into...
Neville Sanderson.
What? But who? But how? But him? But...
Yes, exactly. In Neville Sanderson, you have met your final adversary, Jenny Flamisto. For I can turn you into an advertising voiceover.
Never. You wouldn't dare. You know, but which gave me...
Because you're lovely, Fevlon have created Spring Mist, a new kind of fragrance for a new kind of woman.
You see? And how about this?
Now, there is a lavatory cleanser that goes clear to the pain. New double-action floosh. First a decongestant to soothe and disinfect. Then a new kind of freshener that goes on working. All the fat, half the taste. That's the floosh promise.
Alexander Grise, if I can turn to you. People seem to be turning into people rather a lot. Does it come off as a piece of radio theatre, do you think?
Well, I could only wish that someone would turn into Rupert Dean.
Yes, turning to our audience now. Bishop Arnold, reactions, thoughts, inferences?
Stephen, I wonder if you do your level best to comply with my wish to be allowed to read this piece of paper here.
Oh, fire away, Bish.
You've been listening to Saturday Night Fry, written and presented by Stephen Fry, starring Hugh Laurie and Emma Thompson. Tonight's guest stars were Barry Cryer and David Bowie. Additional material by Ian Brown and James Henry. The show was produced by Dan Patterson. Stephen, could you do your level best to comply with my wish to get Rupert Dean to read that? I think it would particularly suit his honey-toned, velvet-throated, sweet and youthful voice.
No, I'm sorry. Time, the old enemy, has vanquished us once more, but don't forget to join us when we serve up another skillet full of breadcrumb surprises in next week's Soter of Saturday Night Fry.
Now, if you ever want to get a fist in your eye, just mention a Saturday Night Fish Fry. I don't care how many fish in the sea, but don't ever mention a fish to me. It was rocking, it was rocking. You never seen such stuffing and shoving till the break of dawn. It was rocking. Shuffling and shuffling till the break of dawn.